Another term I'm going to be using that you need to know and understand is metadata. Metadata is any data that doesn't directly expose any sensitive information, but can be used to expose information about us. For example, libraries use metadata to sort books by title, author, and publishing information. Having two of any of these three things is enough information to find that book, open it up, and view the contents. This is very similar to our digital lives, where even though your messages may be encrypted, there could be metadata collected like who's talking to who, at what time, for how long. All things that can be used to figure out what is being said. We're going to explore this further after a quick message. Hello, Go Incognito viewers. Just a quick reminder that I have an awesome merch store called the Lemur Shop, where you can rep awesome projects like Monero, hate on other ones that are terrible, and you can rep this course and the channel with your friends and family. If you use the promo code Techlore at checkout before October 20th, you will receive 15% off of your order. If you're watching this after October 20th, well, make sure to follow me on one of the channel platforms because I will post discounts on them periodically. Thanks again, and enjoy the rest of the lesson. A post by Kurt Opsahl from the EFF, a digital rights group, gives a few examples as to why metadata can be so dangerous. They know you rang a phone sex service at 2:24 a.m. and spoke for 18 minutes, but they don't know what you talked about. They know you called the suicide prevention hotline from the Golden Gate Bridge, but the topic of the call remains a secret. They know you spoke with an HIV testing service, then your doctor, then your health insurance company, in the same hour, but they don't know what was discussed. So just because the contents of the call or message are confidential doesn't mean there isn't data being collected that can give more than enough information to figure things out. One organization who abuses metadata is PhiSup, who oversees all requests for surveillance warrants against foreign individuals in the US, which seems reasonable since it requires a court order. The problem is that in 2012, 1,856 requests were presented, and 1,856 requests were approved. After the court grants a request, law enforcement can force private corporations to turn over all of your data, and specifically metadata, assuming they haven't already done so. Now, I might be saying, this doesn't impact me. I'm not one of those 1,856 people. Well, if you're following the tips in this course, you could raise a lot of suspicions, so yes, it still may concern you, even if you don't do anything wrong. On top of that, one person can ruin it for everybody. When the FBI was trying to get Edward Snowden's emails on LavaBit, they forced LavaBit to hand over the SSL keys, which wouldn't just let the FBI access Snowden's keys, but everyone on LavaBit, giving access to all LavaBit users' private emails. When the FBI wanted Apple to unlock the single iPhone from the San Bernardino case, it meant installing a backdoor which would give them access to any iPhone around the world. When VPN companies are forced to keep logs to catch a user, it typically means keeping logs on all users on a server. So, yes, you might not be committing the crime, but you're suffering the privacy invasion, which, without getting too off topic, is why metadata can be just as revealing as the contents in your text, emails, and operating systems. A person who fell victim to this metadata was John McAfee, a cybersecurity expert, and although people don't typically like him as a person, he spreads a lot of good information related to privacy and security. He developed the McAfee antivirus, which many of you might be using right now. McAfee didn't have the cleanest life though, as he admits to living sexual fantasies with guns and bath salts in Belize, where he was accused of killing his neighbor. He eventually fled and went into hiding. So, how did law enforcement find him? It wasn't from his blog post detailing what happened, it was actually from a picture he posted on Twitter. The picture contained exchangeable image file data, or EXIF data, which is photo metadata. It includes things like color saturation and other color details, as well as the exact location that a picture was taken. This is how he was eventually tracked, and this is why your camera on your smartphones asks for your location the first time you start it up. To view the metadata of your files, you can use sites like these to see what kind of information there is on a file. There are programs and sites out there that claim to delete metadata on your files, so definitely take a look at them. For Android, there's Scrambled EXIF, Photo EXIF for jailbroken iOS devices, View EXIF for non-jailbroken iOS devices, and the LiveOS tools includes a tool as well. We will discuss Tails in section 4 of the course. And that's it! Thank you for watching. I know this stuff might not be the most fun to learn about, but it is necessary to know, and it only gets better from here, I promise. We have to cover all the basic terms so we can learn about the advanced things later on. I'll see you in the next lesson discussing a neat thing called the convenience line. See you soon.